This is the story of a young Irish singer. It begins in the basement of a Dublin pub in the year 2000, shortly after the release of his first album.
See this stuff, I don't like this. Solo. Damien Dempsey there. Mundy's from Offaly. Sam Hayes is from Tipperary. My wife's from Dublin and I can't even sell out a gig in my own town. Because if I go down to Ballyporty, it would be sold out, you know? Or it ran out.
I mean, if you want to be a singer, if you're going to be a singer, you've got to go for it. And you've got to work at it. And you've got to keep doing it. But you're not going to survive if you're doing it with an eye to commercial success. You've got to do it because you love this thing that you do. You have to do it because you love lyrics and because you love music and because you love laying it out to an audience. And if you get lucky, you may become commercially successful.
Here you go. And give us a hand tonight, Roy. Sing along the choruses with me, if you know them, because that's what they're there for.
When I was quite a bit older than Damien is now before I enjoyed the fruits of commercial success, and it was a total fluke. It really was. It was just, I recorded this song and if people took to it.
What song was that?
Don't forget your shovel if you want to go to work, you know? And I think it went out as a B-side of a single or something. And Ronan Collins started playing it at 6:30 every morning in RTE. And that was my turning point. And had that not happened, I'd like to think I would still be a singer today. Because it happened in 1984 and I'd been singing for 20 years then. You know?
Factories, trains and houses, playground of my youth, the place that left me mute, till I threw back my shoulders.
When I got married, we lived in Ballymun. Flat in Ballymun. And from there we moved out here, Corporation Purchase House. That's how we got out of Ballymun. That'll be 1970 to 71. Coming from a six-floor flat, that made it was great for us and the kids.
A little red-headed lad wrapped up in swaddling, coming back from the hospital. We were Seven Gardy would have been about 9 or 10, weren't we?
Yeah, about that.
When he was born. And he was a surprise anyway. We weren't expecting another brother popping into the family, to be honest with you. I think the man that were surprised as well.
Following me around with little hammer. I used to repair cars. You had the car out in the back. And then I told Alex about him giving me a hand to work with me. There'd be about 3 or 4 at that time. It was like a little shadow.
I don't know, I always felt up to about 3 or 4. Damien was very outgoing, because he used to get up on an old sofa at my mother's and he'd have a little makey-up guitar and he'd be up singing and dancing away. And then it seemed to be when he went to school, he got very suppressed insofar as that. It was there, but it wasn't being brought out, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, he was always a great kid, quiet kid, you know. Very quiet kid. He couldn't get a word out. I don't remember talking to him. He was about 10.
I thought he was a mute.
So it's quite a surprise. Well, it was quite a surprise when he started to, you know, express himself with music.
Some boys want to get me because I hit one by.
Well, he was pestering me for a guitar. Some of his mates had guitars. So in the end, I gave in and we got him one. And we got him lessons.
But he just took to it like a fish to water. The first one that really struck a chord was a song called Cardboard City. And he, my dad had entered him into the Yoplait Song Contest in RTA. I actually drove him over and went into the studios with him. And there was a guy there, an RTA guy, plays piano, brought him in, took the song. He sat down, put Damien beside him at the piano. And he played the song on this grand piano, big grand piano in one of the studios in RTA. And I remember looking at Damien and going, this song has balls. He said to Damien, you know? And that night he was performing live with Ian Dempsey and a 30-piece orchestra. And I tell you, it just blew me away. I remember looking at Gary saying, where the fuck did that come from? It's a song, he's only, what was he, 15, 16?
Rubble.
Decided he was leaving school. When I said to him, what are you going to do? And he said, I want to go to the Rock School in Ballyferm. And when I said, I thought, Jesus, you know, the Rock School in Ballyferm. But he had made up his mind, that's what he was doing, and he was going, if Damien decides what he's going to do, that's what he's going to do. And I knew then there was no point in me saying, hey or nay, you're not going there, you know. I kind of thought, Jesus, he's going to end up on the streets, you know.
See the sunset over St. Thomas. See the sunset over us all. See the sunset over St. Thomas. See the sunset over the world.
You know, for years he was a little brother. Next of all, he was this, you know, young man standing there doing something that, when he started singing first, a lot of people were giving him a lot of negative vibes, you know? A lot of negative crap being travelling at him. Saying, what are you singing like that for? Lose the accent. You're fucking brutal. You know, and he still gets a lot of that. But I remember hearing him say at an early age, that only makes me stronger.
Fuck them,
man. And the more they say that, you know, and I mean, that in itself was a very mature thing to be saying to those times. That would have, like, I was, that would have shattered me, you know what I mean? If that had been, I was like, fuck, I'm giving that up, I'm crap at that, you know?
My first meeting with Damien was out in Ballyferm at the Rock School, and he was just enrolling like everybody else. He was in the class. But after class, I would always say, look, I have a gig in town, a songwriter's night, and it's Tuesday night upstairs in the International. And I said, you're all very welcome to come in. And he came in one night, and that was it. That was my first time meeting. The whole idea of it was to arrive at the door with a guitar, whether you were Joe Bloggs or whoever, from wherever. It didn't matter. You didn't have to be a name.
I encountered him at the International. I used to drop in there occasionally. And I heard the head there one night, and I was just very taken by what he was doing.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Damien Dempsey. Well, there was a buzz about him in the college because the college used to put out a CD of the better half of talent that was in the school, and for two or three artists on the one CD. In this case, they felt this guy was so good, so original, that they gave him the whole CD, the Contender EP. Oh, well, I'm still thinking vinyl here. The Contender CD, and there was a big buzz about him.
The fact that he was singing in his own accent, it tickled me, the way they really put it out there, that he wasn't trying to sound like a Yank, you know?
How is all doing? I cut my teeth here about 6.5 years ago. And if I hadn't got started playing here, I'd probably be working on construction or something now. I'd be earning like a wage, you know, it'd be great.
Obviously, people were like, you know, he was different. Now, he's different to the Casey's, because Casey's and the Hanses are still writing in what you would call a pop genre, you know, whereas Damien is outside of that, and he's in a folk element. So I would say what he's managed to get into his songs is a twist between the standard ballad, and because he grew up with reggae and all of that, so his rhythms are more interesting and are a little different, yet he still retains the Irish ethnic sort of, you know it's Irish directly, you know?
Everybody seemed to think it's there you bear the pain, there you bear the biggest cross, the loneliness and the shame. Day to day you suffer when you're living in your past. If you started living for the now, you could free yourself at last. If you started living for the now, for yourself and those around, experience and celebrate the freedom that you found. You could free yourself forever, live life as you should. The choice is yours to take now, cause I have set out on a code. But I know that sometimes it gets so bad, but you're not on your own, so don't be sad.
I really think he hasn't a clue just how talented he is and what it actually means. I mean, he has no real concept of what it means, what his material and his songs mean, and the lyrics to his audience.
Well, if you feel real bad, then you're not on your own tonight. Please don't be so sad, cause you're not on your own tonight.
I don't know that he'll ever get up there, if you know what I mean. Unless he gets really serious management who know the trail and know where to put him. He's not gonna fall by the wayside, no, but like, it's nice to be recognized in the throes of doing it. When you're young, that's the time to do it.
Well, if you feel real bad, then you're not on your own. Please don't be so sad, cause you're not.
To convince people of your talent, you've got to be serious, but you've got to believe it, and you've got to show people that you believe it. You know, and you've got to be, if you want, for a better word, you've got to be egotistical to a degree, to a level. But he's just such a quiet, soft-spoken gentleman. He really is.
I've a big box of prose like in my bag for anyone who wants some after this song. This is called Factories, Trains and Houses.
Damien's first album was released in 2000. Critically, it was a success, but commercially, it was a dismal failure. There was little money to promote it, so it never got played on the radio and it never got into the charts. Disillusioned by its failure, Damien decided he needed a break from Ireland. He went to New York to play gigs in a friend's pub and hoped to get some work labouring. But in the summer before 9/11, New York was already in recession.
I was stuck in a rut in Dublin. I had to get out. And it started broken up with my old manager, Ingmar Kiang. He'd sort of take me as far as he could, you know. But now there's nobody on the scene, no managers, no record companies, nothing really. Can't get you down, you think you're going nowhere, you know. You think I'm going to be blink and I'm going to be 30 now. Saying, I could have made it, you know. A bit of shite sitting in America.
Do you think singing makes you middle class because you're working for yourself?
I think singing makes me middle class. Of course. Actually upper class if you ask me. I don't think singers are any class really. Well, they shouldn't be. I don't feel like I'm any class. I don't treat anyone like they're upper or lower class, you know. I think it's... everyone's just taking my face value, you know? Like Protestants, Catholics, Blacks, Asians, whatever. We're all just people, you know? There's some great people out there. Some wonderful people from all walks of life. So, a singer should be just... you know, sort of... they should be wise, sort of spiritual sort of human beings. But, fortunately, a lot of them wouldn't fit into that category. I'm trying to get there, you know. One day I will. I met a guy in Dublin. Chris Bourne is his name. He formed a great band, Irish American band called Black 47, you know? Him and another guy from Wexford, Freddy Kirwan. They're very big over here, you know? And he just saw me and asked me to come over and play in his bar. And I came over and played, and he got me a few other gigs.
Still we're not free, and your mother cries, and you ask God why.
It was a pretty lean summer. I thought I'd get a job, you know, a bit of labouring, a bit of construction work, but there wasn't much work at all around, you know. I think pain can bring out a lot of songs and people, you know. If you're going through pain, like, seems to be a good instigator for songwriting, you know. Like, I had an allergic reaction, you know, and took an Advil for a headache, and I didn't know you weren't meant to drink alcohol with them. And I got about 300 hives all over me, and it was pretty bad now. They all started itching and all, and they all filled up with pus, and it was very painful. I know you couldn't sleep and all, so I was going through a good few days, bad days, you know. I wrote some great songs in them days, you know.
Starvation was the only life you know, in a two-room shack, then jailed and let her frack.
It's the classic album, you know. It's the linchpin song is Colony, you know what I mean? Where he gives it to the bread straight up the arse, you know what I mean? Where they always deserve to get it.
You came from Germany, from France, from England and from Spain, from Belgium and from Portugal, you all done much the same. You took what was not yours, went against your own Bible. You broke your own laws just to outdo the rival. But did you ever apologize for the hundreds of millions of lives you destroyed and terrorized? Have you never realized? Did you never feel shame for what was done in your country's name? And find out who to blame and why that was so inhumane until they teach it in your school. Build those glorious days of rule, how it's your destiny to be. To me, but if you've any kind of mind, you'll see that all humankind are the children of this earth, and your hate for them will chew you up and spit you out.
At the moment, I regard him as a musician that's walking the thin line between the tribe and the world, you know. I'd like to see him just leave the tribe and become a tribune of the world, of the working class in the world.
You're never killer with the people.
He's similar to me as a songwriter, yeah? In that he describes the way things really are, which is a pile of shit, you know what I mean? But then he also sees the beauty that is Ireland, and it is Ireland's past, and that can be Ireland's future, you know what I mean? Like, if we stop, you know, apologising for being Irish, you know what I mean?
Leave it.
Monday.
Fucking drinking every shot.
Party glass in New York, last drink of New York. I just wrote this about New York being the apple of my eye, you know. My favourite city outside Dublin, you know. I don't know if it's any use, but I'll give it a lash anyway.
Damien returned home to some good news. One of his heroes had covered his song It's All Good with the Bristol band Massive Attack.
You won't get rid of me that easily.
Where did you hear of Damien Dempsey, or how did you come to know about him?
John Reynolds, who's my son's father, but also my best friend, and also someone who I've worked with since I was about 18. He's produced a lot of my records.
Oh, I went to see a friend of mine playing up at the Shepherd's Empire, Hot House Flowers, and Damien was doing the support slot, and I started to watch the show and realised he was far too quiet, so I went up and spoke to the sound man about it and tried to get a good sound for him. I went and bought the CD from the Tower Records. And then I loved the CD so much I went and bought it for everybody that I knew.
And then John sent me a copy of the album, so which he said I should hear just because of the title.
Just loved the truth in the voice, really. That thing that you're always looking for when somebody sings, you know, that kind of soul thing, you know, that where you just, you just believe what people sing when they really mean it, and you really don't believe people when they don't really mean it, and that's the unlistenable stuff, you know.
In a way, I think he represents the sort of voice in Ireland that is not allowed to be heard, you know, that there's Ireland quite snobby in a lot of ways and always has been, and there are opportunities for people who speak like I do, but often not for people who speak like Damien does, and whole worlds are closed to people because of how they speak or where they come from or the kind of things they're talking about, you know.
When I met you, Ned, how did it feel? I chuffed, you know. It's just because I had hoard up my wall for years and years as a boy. And next thing you're meeting her and then she's singing one of your songs, like, it's like a dream come true, you know. It's like Gabrielle said, dreams can't come true.
But obviously he could sing anything, but as traditional Irish singers go, I don't think there's ever been anyone like him. Like, even Luke Kelly and all those people, like, they were good, but I think Damien just wipes the floor with them, so.
And I think I was in Dublin. Was I in Dublin? Yeah, anyway, I got in touch with him and said, if he wants to come over and do a couple of tunes at the house, we'd just do it, you know, have some fun and see what happened.
Oh, the great gales of Ireland and the great gales of Scotland, they were kept down for so long. Now they wanted was freedom.
I ran the tape and the whole song, I mean, the whole guitar and song and Damien as he is was so holistic as a sound, where he seems to have the whole song within him and the guitar. So anything that I'm going to do is really going to just be shifting it a little bit, you know. That's how I feel about it, really. And not fucking anything up.
I think the setup here in John's apartment here is great. It's just like being at home, writing songs and practicing. You know, you're not sitting there with these big borders up around you, like in a studio on the big screen there, and there's loads of people in the recording room twiddling knobs and looking into you, you know. It's a real sterile atmosphere. This is great. You're just sitting in a bedroom, you're looking out over the housetops of London, you know. I was chuffed, you know, to work with a fella like John. But I've heard of Sinead's albums and then I found out that he had produced them and that, you know, and worked on them. And that was a big thrill, you know, because I think they're brilliant. It's a trip to be working with them. Doesn't seem like work at all. I suppose it isn't, really.
So I kicked off this track with acoustics and voice like we did all the others, and lived with it for a bit and thought it needed to be probably hardened up rather than softened with strings and stuff. So brought in a very heavy dub bass player that I play with all the time, and a hard, quite a hard sounding drum kit. So the track sounds more contemporary now. It sounds more. It'll sit along other side, alongside other tracks if you listen to it on the radio or things like that. So we developed that side of it, which was. Funnily enough, I was working in the studio one day with Sinead, and I played her the track down quite late at night, and she loved the track and said, you know, look, I've got an idea immediately. Can I just sing it down? So she sang a kind of an ethereal choir type vocal on it. So we built a little choir of Damien at the back to go along with Sinead. I was doing something with Brian Eno, and he was in the studio, and I was working on this track as he arrived and said, oh, well, you know, I've got a great idea for that track. Do you mind if I just play it down? And so he picked up the guitar and played this very kind of funky, unorthodox, slidey guitar. Which, when you drop it into the track, changes the kind of rhythm of the track really beautifully. Kid steals your jacket and does time. Just look at the... So... Beautiful end, this. I wanted to kind of hit it home rather than let it just be a song, you know.
When the album's finished, just going to throw it out there and hope somebody, maybe a record company will license it. We can license it to a record company. And I'm going to make sure they do a good job of promoting the thing, because I want people to hear it. If they don't do a good job promoting it, someone's got it.
Damien was a very good boxer. Very good. Even that's 15, 16. Could have been far, could have been place. Even heard the lads say it.
But a couple of fights for Dublin, hadn't he?
The last fight we saw him fight, he fought a traveller from Dundalk. Up in the ring, so that was a bloodbath.
Two of them knocked the bollocks out of each other. He was pipped for it, hadn't he? He wasn't forced to the punch on the night. He went to three rounds. But he got out, man, I tell you. The great young fella.
It's kind of music, I mean, you're coming out and your hands are swollen, your fingers, your wrists are swollen, you're playing guitar then, you know. It's kind of one or the other.
It's like boxing in a sense, you're getting into the ring on your own. You know, it's not a team sport, it's not a team player's game. You get up there, you know, with music, you bare your soul. Especially with the line of stuff he's doing and the start of stuff he's doing.
I'm busy, man.
Fucking heavy.
Filming.
What?
I'm in the middle of a film.
John Reynolds took over as Damien's manager, and Sinead invited him to play support on her European tour.
People say that the home gigs are, the more you get more nervous when you're in playing your hometown. I don't know why you would. Maybe it's because half your family are there, and they know if you're doing like a half good gig, they'll probably know it.
When Sinead first asked me to come on tour, I thought she wanted me to do security. But she actually wanted me to warm up the crowd, so the large brandies are on me.
I let the nerves in and say, yeah, I'm going to be nervous. I'll deal with it. And it worked.
True.
true. Will you knock me if you're so mighty? Why waste your time with me? Well, if I'm bad, ignorant and sad, why waste your time, you might? Well, you're just mad because your life is sad. You've done nothing worthwhile. But twist their knife because you hate your life. My life you want to spoil.
The fantastic thing that's happened with Damien is that under pressure, he's got better. And that doesn't always happen. You know, it can be under pressure, people can fall to pieces. So, you know, that means he's a warrior, really.
What sort of pressure would he be under?
Large audience pressure, you know. Large audiences that aren't his audience as well, so. I had to ask the players, do they mind playing in Sinead's show and in Damien's show? And the answer was, it would be weird not to. I don't think they could let those songs go by every night without playing on them, so. Brilliant, brilliant response. Great players, great people.
Thank you a lot, Dublin. Invite a few more friends on stage now. Give Sinead O'Connor a big round of applause, please. This song is about the Celtic Tiger.
I thought it was wonderful. Sinead and coming out to sing with me. And that was a great buzz. That was a huge oil to win. Like the 8th gig in Ireland. Big gigs, you know, all over 1,000 people. But I just got into the music tonight and just enjoyed it and just had the eyes closed. It was like coming down, it was like an out-of-body experience.
What up, Margaret Dublin? I was anxious to see that woman as you was there.
The album's complete and mastered. So now we're just ready to tie it to a firework. We've got a great response. Lots and lots of people phoning me instead of me having to phone lots of people, which is a brilliant, brilliant position to be in.
I suppose I learned about his, you know, the commitment to what he's doing, and you know the amount of hours he puts in, you know, as a player. He's playing all the time, singing all the time, writing all the time. And that's, you know, that's just the way that you develop, you know, in that really big way. It's been a great support from everyone on the tour. It's just been one big happy family, which is pretty rare, you know. It's normally a few fights.
And that's how you do the sound check. I learned a lot about John, you know. I learned he's a chronic alcoholic. He likes the hotel part a little bit too much, you know. Nah, we just got out of like, we're like long lost brothers. Now we're going on great.
5,000 people. No,
I'm used. My name is Damien Dempsey. I'm terrified, but I'll give her a lash anyway.
This is a song about a few Irish writers and poets who enjoy the snifter of port at Christmas.
Different types of styles of music is that the essence of soul within all those types of music is the same. And all those players are very soulful players and understand each other. So as soon as they come together, really, they just find a common ground, you know.
Have a great night. Thanks very much.
Tour is great. It just toughens you up, you know. It's, you could compare it to, say, if you're a boxer and you're going out, you know, and having big fights and big arenas with good opposition, you know. At the end of it, you'd be, you know, you'd be bulletproof, you know. I think what Sinead does is, and Sarah McGowan and anyone I was ever into, it was just, it's just a way of life for them, you know. It's not about the marketing or the making loads of money or, you know, how they look in the camera and all this and how they come across. It's just their way of life. They're just totally expressing themselves and being themselves and just releasing anything they have inside them.
Bring me the head of Louis Walsh.
Got me with the big us.
I wasn't fucking ready with a big us at the end.
And it's an ancient thing what they're doing, you know. Same as with Christie, and then with the pop industry and all that shite. It's just, for me, it's just chewing gum. It's just, it's expendable, you know? If it was to disappear totally tomorrow, I don't think anyone would be the worse off, you know? All the good stuff was to stick around. Till everyone will, old hatreds kill, differences will unite. It's important. It's important. It's
important to us. If you see Bobby Sands MP and the time of men followed his lead. There's something fantastically honest about Damien's face, something incredibly open. And I meant to say, he reminded me of Woody Guthrie's face. Like, I'm not to say that Woody Guthrie didn't do bad things in that sense, or that Damien is kind of some paragon of virtue. But what it is, like, Orwell says every man gets the face he deserves at 50. That face is your sort of appointment with your future. It sort of says, Damien's face says to me is that he might go wrong for a while, but, like, he'll come back until he fills that face properly. That's what I think about him. That's everyone will, old hatreds kill, differences will
unite, it's important. He reaches right back, that's the whole point. If you listen carefully, Shanachie is not a tradition that started in the 19th century, it's a tradition that's just prehistoric, you know what I mean? It's the way our history has been preserved, you know what I mean?
He's been sincere in his language, and he's been sincere in his train of thought, and he's not trying to copy anybody. He's doing his own thing, you know, and if those very same people who are critical of that now will be totally supportive when he gains acceptance, you know, and when he reaches where he is going to reach, then the very same people who are saying, oh, we always knew Damien would be, you know, we always loved him from the very start. People are fickle.
got Jimmy Head and playing along with Sinead O'Connor, or Lil Shane or Christie or someone. I just feel blessed, you know. Thought I got a chance to play with them. And if I die tomorrow, I'll be a happy man. What I get from Sinead's music? Strength. Bliss when I hear her voice, you know. I can break her heart.
Labels don't get it, they just don't see what's the point, you know what I mean? So so I think in a lot of ways people are better off, Irish singers are better off staying out of that. So
yeah, we had a few offers. We've put a label together called Clear, and we're gonna release the record out through that label. And we've gone to Sony, which is exactly what we wanted to do, so we could keep retaining everything that we'd worked on. Things couldn't be better right now. Complete artistic control for the next, well, forever. And we've got a huge support structure underneath it when we need it and if we need it.
How do we feel about the album being in there? It's in the shops.
Yeah.
Not over the moon. Finally. In 3 years now, you know. Floating around in the wilderness. Doing labouring through the winter. Going around the arse, hanging down my trousers. Scraping up tuppence and pennies to get the bus around the bleeding town. And I believe it's only going to get worse now. Going to have less money for the next few years.
Seize the Day entered the Irish charts at number 5. Damien made the cover of Hot Press magazine and appeared on The Late Late Show with Pat Kenny. Sinead's version of It's All Good was released on her album She Who Dwells.
I know that smell, man. That's expensive.
That's a fruit.
Fruit?
If you take two kids, say, and you give one verbal abuse and, you know, put them down and, you know, tell them they're brutal or whatever,
you know, that it'll hinder them in life. And you take a good kid and encourage them and be positive with them, you know, and, you know, tell them they're good. They'll blossom. So, that's what it's all good is about, and just the fact that you have to love yourself.
Yeah, what's yeah. next, John?
So good.
That's tough going on, sir.
Give me a show whenever you take, you want to go back on?
Yeah, we're ready.